The construction of job number 552, the reference given to the project to build a second Cunard superliner by the John Brown shipyard at Clydebank, began in December 1936 with the laying of the first keel plates. As the ship took shape, all the necessary components were produced and prepared for installation. Thousands of items were made locally, whilst others arrived from across Britain and overseas. From the 10 million rivets to the 140-ton rudder with its own inspection door, the boilers and equipment, and of course the decorative works of art, soft furnishings, furniture, tableware, and much more besides. The Queen Elizabeth was to be like a small floating village. By the autumn of 1938, number 552 was ready to be launched. The scheduled date was the 27th of September, and the ceremony was to be carried out by Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, consort of George VI. An estimated 250,000 turned out to watch the Queen christened the world's largest liner. Accompanying her was Princess Elizabeth, who in turn would one day perform a similar task when naming the QE2. And the ship was a prime target. On the 26th of February 1940, making use of an especially high tide, the ship was ready to leave. Unlike her sister ship, however, the Lizzie's first outing was a secret 3,000-mile dash across the North Atlantic in camouflage grey during World War II. Painted in camouflage grey, the Queen Elizabeth made a dash across the Atlantic. Her first arrival in New York was very much in contrast to that of the Queen Mary's nearly 4 years earlier, and a far cry to that originally planned. For the first and last time, the three largest liners ever built, the two Cunarders and their French rival Normandy, laid side by side. ¶¶ after the war, she underwent a complete refit and embarked upon her first commercial voyage as one of the world's fastest and most luxurious passenger ships. 16th of October was set as the date for the ship's official maiden voyage, but before that, she underwent a number of sea trials to thoroughly test and adjust her machinery and equipment. Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, who had been following the progress of her namesake, together with Princesses Elizabeth and Margaret, were invited aboard the Finnish ship to observe her being put through her paces in the Firth of Clyde. After lunch, once underway, Her Majesty even took a turn at the helm. Chapter in the history of the ship, and indeed the Cunard line, was about to begin. The company's second superliner was about to embark upon the career for which she was intended, under the captaincy of Commodore Sir James Bissett. A great sense of excitement was gripping the nation. According to schedule, at 2 p.m. on the 16th of October, the Lizzie left Southampton on her first commercial voyage. Days and 16 hours later, she arrived in New York, having completed the journey at an average of 27.99 knots. She was the first passenger liner to enter the port since the war, and New York gave her a rapturous welcome. For the next 10 years, the two Cunard queens would rule the North Atlantic. In a glamorous age of travel, she attracted the patronage of royalty and the rich and famous. They included Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, Charlie Chaplin, and Laurel and Hardy. They were pampered with the very best cuisine and service amidst legendary splendor and elegance. Back as the late 1920s, Sir Percy Bates, chairman of the Cunard line, introduced the concept of a two-ship weekly service across the Atlantic, carrying primarily passengers and mail. Passenger lists boasting, among other names, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother. The Duke and Duchess of Windsor, and many a celebrity. This was the heyday of post-war liner travel. Transatlantic crossings were still mainly by sea, and the Cunard sister ships were seen as the only way to cross.
100,000 surging horsepower demands the utmost in training and experience. On this 83,000-ton vessel, the rudder alone weighs more than the Mayflower, which brought the Pilgrim Fathers across the sea to America. With all the miraculous instruments of modern navigation, including radar and electronic sounding devices, it still takes men. Men raised in the finest tradition of the sea to guide the Queen Elizabeth, largest moving structure in the world, across the far horizons of the North Atlantic.
But by the late 1960s, with increasing numbers of passengers opting to fly rather than sail the Atlantic, Cunard's Queens were to be pensioned off. Inevitably, the Queen Elizabeth was sold, destined to become an attraction berthed permanently in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. On the 28th of November 1968, she left Southampton for the last time. Manned by a skeleton crew of Cunard employees, the ship remained at the port, which at this time had yet to be developed as a centre for cruising. Although the ship was open to the public, her purchasers went broke, and she was sold by auction to shipping millionaire C.Y. Tung of Hong Kong. His dream was to convert the ship to a touring education centre, which he was to call the C.Y.'s University. Mr. Tung's dream started to take shape. ...1,000 Chinese employees had the task of refurbishing the vessel. Lavish fittings, classrooms and laboratories were installed, with accommodation for 20 lecturers and 800 students. CY's University was to embark upon a two-year world cruise. But at 11:30 on the 9th of January 1972, Mr. Tung's dream came to an end.